Second Chronicles 21. Have a little Bible study here. I get a lot of instruction by looking at the kings in the Old Testament, because when you read the story of someone's life, you know, God always tells the story the way it happened. Not the way someone would want to interpret it, but he tells what happened. And so God's account of a man's life is accurate. And when we look at how God gives an account of someone's life, it ought to cause us to stop and take notice, because we're also writing a story. And if we're not careful, we'll just repeat the same mistakes that other people made in their story. But if we're given to wisdom, then we will look at God's accounting of these men's lives, and we'll learn from their mistakes or learn from how they please the Lord, and we can get some help. And so, of course, the old adage is, those that don't learn from history are bound to repeat it. And so many times, a lot of these kings repeated the same problems. And just like church members and Christians and people repeat the same problems. But I want to write a good story. But whether I write a good one or a bad one, God's going to tell it like it happened, see. So let's look at this story of this king. And we'll start in 2 Chronicles 21. The king we're looking at is Jehoram. 2 Chronicles 21:1. Now, Jehoshaphat, if you don't know who he was, you'd have to read the preceding chapters. He's a good guy. He's a good king. Now, he wasn't without his faults. And to be honest with you, though he loved the Lord with all of his heart, the fault that he had in his life ruined his children. Isn't that sad? That you can, you know, if you take a rocket shot to the moon, if you're off just a little bit, you'll miss by a mile. And you don't have to be off very much, but if you're off just a little bit, the farther out you go, the farther off you are. And so that's what happened with Jehoshaphat. He's a great king, but he was off a little bit. And he compromised in some things and wasn't as separated as he ought to have been. And because of that, he survived, but his kids didn't. And that's a whole nother message that I have on Jehoshaphat. But I want to tell you, parents, something. You know, you can survive as a Christian, and you can love the Lord as a Christian and not be totally separated, but your kids won't survive that. Now, you can take that or leave it, but I've watched enough people's lives and seen enough stories, and that's the truth. Now, separation is not the sum of Christianity. It doesn't mean you have a heart for God. But if we're not separated from the world, our kids don't have a chance. That's just the truth. And Jehoshaphat loved God with all of his heart, but because he wasn't as separated as he should have been, it destroyed Jehoram, his son. Now let's read about it. 2 Chronicles 21, verse 1. Now Jehoshaphat slept with his fathers and was buried with his fathers in the city of David. And Jehoram, his son, reigned in his stead. And he had brethren, the sons of Jehoshaphat, Azariah and Jehiel and Zechariah and Azariah and Michael. And you know, that's something there. The guy named two of his kids the same name. That's sort of strange, isn't it? Call one Azariah 1 and Azariah 2, I don't know, but anyway. And Michael and Shephatiah, all these were the sons of Jehoshaphat, king of Israel. And their father gave them great gifts of silver and of gold and of precious things with fenced cities in Judah, but the kingdom gave he to Jehoram because he was the firstborn. Now when Jehoram was risen up to the kingdom of his father, he strengthened himself and slew all his brethren with a sword, and divers also of the princes of Israel. Jehoram was 32 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 8 years in Jerusalem. And he walked in the way of the kings of Israel, like as did the house of Ahab. For he had the daughter of Ahab to wife. and he wrought that which was evil in the eyes of the Lord. Howbeit, the Lord would not destroy the house of David because of the covenant that he had made with David. And as he promised to give him a light, to give a light to him and to his sons forever, in his days, the Edomites revolted from under the dominion of Judah and made themselves a king. And Jehoram went forth with his princes and all his chariots with him, and he rose up by night and smote the Edomites which compassed him in, and the captains of the chariots. So the Edomites revolted from under the hand of Judah unto this day. The same time also did Libna revolt from under his hand, because he had forsaken the Lord God of his fathers. Moreover, he made high places in the mountains of Judah and caused the inhabitants of Jerusalem to commit fornication and compelled Judah thereto. And there came a writing to him from Elijah the prophet, saying, Thus saith the Lord God of David thy father, because thou hast not walked in the ways of Jehoshaphat thy father, nor in the ways of Asa king of Judah, but hast walked in the way of the kings of Israel, and hast made Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to go a-whoring, like to the whoredoms of the house of Ahab, and also hast slain thy brethren of thy father's house, which were better than thyself. Behold, with a great plague will the Lord smite thy people and thy children, thy wives, and all thy goods, and thou shalt have great sickness by disease of thy bowels, until thy bowels fall out by reason of the sickness day by day. Merry Christmas. God loves you. Smile. You don't hear too many messages delivered by God's servants like that. 16. Moreover, the Lord stirred up against Jehoram the spirit of the Philistines. So we've already got the Edomites stirred up against him, and we've got the Libnites stirred up against him. So now we've got the Philistines stirred up against him. And of the Arabians, now the Arabians are stirred up against him that were near the Ethiopians. You know, it doesn't ever pay to do right. Or to do wrong. It doesn't ever pay to do wrong. Never does. And they came into Judah, verse 17, and brake into it and carried away all the substance that was found in the king's house, and his sons also and his wives, so that there was never a son left him, save Jehoahaz, the youngest of his sons. And after all this, the Lord smote him in his bowels with an incurable disease. And it came to pass that in process of time, after the end of 2 years, his bowels fell out by reason of his sickness. So he died of sore diseases, and his people made no burning for him like the burning of his fathers. 32 years old was he when he began to reign, and he reigned in Jerusalem 8 years and departed without being desired. Howbeit, they buried him in the city of David, but not in the sepulcher of the kings. Father, I pray that you would bless the reading of your word and bless the word of God to our hearts and help us, Lord, to learn from these things. And God, as we look around, we see people also smitten with an incurable disease, and it's on the inside of them. And Lord, I pray that you would deliver us from that incurable disease. Deliver us from that disease on the inside that comes because of the judgment of God, because we followed a path that was our path instead of your path. Help us now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, King Jehoram, wonderful message tonight on being diseased in your bowels. An incurable disease. A sore disease. And I want to know why he got that, because that was sent from God. You know, I look around and I see people that you wonder if God can even help them. They're so messed up. They're messed up from the inside out. We live in a reprobate world. I told my dad today, I shocked him because, you know, I've been praying about things. I said, Dad, I've made a decision. I'm moving to India. He looked at me and he dropped his mouth and said, What? I said, I'm moving to India. I said, I read today where the Supreme Court of India, anybody read that? Well, we got one astute young man here, amen. the Supreme Court of India upheld that it is a crime to commit a homosexual act in the country of India. Punishable up to 10 years in prison. Hindus that worship gods with 50 million arms and 5, 6, 7 heads have got more sense than a Christian nation. It's a crime. And they're going crazy, you know. It's a crime, it said. And they interviewed one of the judges. He said, it's a heinous crime. It's just wrong. He said, it's a sin. This guy's not a Christian. It's bad when non-Christians have more morals than Christians. It's really bad. But anyway, we live in a reprobate society that seems to have an incurable disease. And not just sodomy, but everything. It's just bent against God. And you wonder if there's even a cure for it. Well, this man had the judgment of God in his life, and God said there ain't going to be a cure for it. You're going to die with this. And I think some nations die with an incurable disease. I think some people, they wreck their lives so bad that they just can't get a cure, and that might not be popular, but I didn't say they lost their salvation. I just said there's some things that can't be cured when you mess yourself up so bad. It was incurable. I know it was of the body, but I want to see why. It was a judgment of God. But why did he have this? Well, let's look and see, because we don't want this. Anybody want to volunteer for a disease in your bowels? I remember I preached it one time. I preached a message in Virginia on hemorrhoids in the secret parts. that's another good one you ought to study over there. And it was a disease. See, it's something on the inside that's wrong, see. In the secret area. When you read in the Bible the word bowels in the New Testament, it's not always talking about a physical part of the body. It's talking about the innermost part of you. You ever read where Paul talked about his own bowels and about in the bowels of Jesus Christ? He's talking about the innermost desire and feeling. And I'm telling you, this guy was smitten by God in his innermost being. Because God looked at it and he said, all right, it's incurable, judgment's coming. Well, what did he do? Well, verse 2, let's start there. The Bible said, and he had brethren, the sons of Jehoshaphat, Azariah and Jael and Zechariah and Azariah and Michael and Shephatiah, all these were the sons of Jehoshaphat, king of Israel. So he grew up with, you know, brothers and brethren, and he grew up with a good dad, and Joram loved the Lord. But the Bible says in verse number 6, and he walked in the way of the kings of Israel, like as did the house of Ahab, for he had the daughter of Ahab to wife, and he wrought that which was evil in the eyes of the Lord. He would not walk in the way of his father. He wouldn't even walk in the way of his grandfather. Look at verse 12. And there came a writing to him from Elijah the prophet, saying, thus saith the Lord God of David thy father, because thou hast not walked in the ways of Jehoshaphat thy father, nor in the ways of Asa king of Judah, but hast walked in the way of the kings of Israel. God smote this man, this king, because he changed pathways. He would not walk in the way of his father, Jehoshaphat. He would not walk in the way of his grandfather, Asa. And he would not walk, obviously, in the ways of David. He said, I'm going to live a different life, a different kind of life than my dad or my granddad. You understand what I'm saying? I'm not going to live like they lived. Now, that's all right if his daddy was a drunk. That's all right if his daddy had been a dopehead. That's all right if his dad had worshipped false gods. Isn't it strange that in society, kids, when they got terrible parents, most of the time they live like they do? And then good kids that have godly parents don't live the way they do? something's messed up there. It is a great, you know what a blessing it was for him to have a father that loved God with all of his heart and have a grandfather that loved God. I mean, you read in that book, and a lot of those kings didn't know God, but his daddy and his granddaddy, they didn't know God. And he said, I don't want to go that way. And he started onto a path to an incurable disease. You know what, young ladies, I say, if you've got a godly mother and a godly grandmother, it'd be good if you live like they did instead of live like somebody else. Because if you don't live like they live, you may just be on the way to an incurable disease. And the young generation, you know, it doesn't matter if it was the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, or the 2000s. They always don't want to be an old fogey and want to go their own way. But that way that seems right unto a man, the end thereof is the way of what? It's Jehoram. I'll do it my way. I think there's something wrong when kids don't want to dress the way their parents dressed. And kids don't want to listen to the music the way their parents, and kids don't want to have the church life the way their, and kids don't want to have the standards in the daily life the way that their parents and their our grandparents and great-grandparents would be ashamed of us the way we live. We have a responsibility to walk in the ways of our Father. If their ways were in the ways of God. Paul said, be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ Jesus. Anything born in this generation isn't worth consideration. I tell my kids, you got an obligation to follow the path of your father and your grandfather and your great-grandfather, amen, and your great-great-great-grandfather, and let's just keep going back because none of them live like this present evil adulterous generation. So, Jehoram, why do you get a disease? Well, you're 32 years old and you don't want to live like daddy. Well, guess what? You're not going to die like daddy either. And you know what's sad about that, folks? Is that if you read 2 Kings chapter 8 when it discusses the reign of Jehoshaphat, for a time at the very end of his life, Jehoram reigned with his father, Jehoshaphat. But he didn't do any of that until his daddy kicked the bucket. You know what that means to me? That means the whole time he was living a lie in front of daddy, and the whole time he was planning out what he was going to do as soon as dad took his last breath, and I'm going to have a different way and a different kingdom and a different lifestyle. And I'm going to get an incurable disease. Well, the first path to an incurable disease, Merry Christmas. I told him not to ask me to preach. Always at Easter time, you know, when they have, I'd preach on hell or something like that, you know, because people would come to church then, they would never, I know you're not like that, but look, I'm interested in people not ruining their lives and not getting a disease that destroys them and their kids. Because, you know the sad thing about this? This didn't just destroy Jehoram. It destroyed everybody around him. I mean, look over there. Look at chapter 21, verse 14. Behold, with a great plague will the Lord smite thy people and thy children, and thy wives and all thy goods. Why? Because of you. Not, look, your wives are going to suffer. Your children are going to suffer. Your people are going to suffer. More people are going to be involved in the judgment that's coming because of your decision than just you. And isn't that the way it always is? Other people are affected when we don't do right. Sinning is such a selfish activity because it never considers who else I'm going to destroy. Why did he get an incurable disease? Because he refused to walk in the way of his father or his grandfather. And then secondly, verse 3, 2 Chronicles 21:3, the Bible said, and their father gave them great gifts. I think that this path to an incurable disease was because he refused to walk in the way of his father. But I also think it's because he wasted the great gifts of his father. He was given so much, and he just threw it to the wind. Look at the Bible here. Verse 3, and their father gave them great, not just gifts, but great gifts. Boy, every good, every perfect gift comes from above. We have a giving God, a giving Father, and God has given and given and given. And I tell you what will incur the judgment of God is being on that end of receiving, receiving, and then take all those great gifts and just throw them away. And not appreciate it and not take it to heart and not it cause something to help my heart. Just receive the gifts like I deserve them. You would think he would have enough thankfulness in his heart to his father because of all the great gifts that he would want to at least honor his memory. But no. Bible says their father gave them great gifts of silver and of gold and of precious things. His dad gave him precious things. One of the most precious things he gave him was a good name and a good testimony. He gave him something precious, and he took that precious thing and he just drug it through the dirt. I think that upset God. Jehoshaphat gave him silver, and he gave him gold, and he gave him precious things. And look at verse 3, he said, with fenced cities in Judah. His dad gave him protection. He not only gave him silver and gold and precious things and all these great gifts, he gave him some fences with it. You with me? He put some barriers to keep out that which would destroy him. Dad had lifted up some fences. I said, Dad had lifted up some fences. He put up some fences. And with all that given to him, you know what he did? He destroyed himself from the inside of the fence. I think it made God mad because he had everything served to him on a silver platter. What wonderful blessing he had, the gift of a throne. I mean, some of his brethren could have been king. I mean, God even says later they were better than he was anyway. You didn't think he'd have stepped back and said, you know, my brothers are better than me, but I got the throne. You'd think there'd be some humility, some thankfulness. No, he took all that he was given, and he wasted it. He wasted everything his father gave him. You know what would be a shame and disgrace? And my dad is more worried about it than we are. I mean, Joel and I tell he and mom to take all their retirement and just blow it and spend it and have a good time. That's what we tell him. He won't listen to us. He's concerned about leaving us something, you know. And he's got a Bible verse for it, so you can't say much. But we want him to just spend it and have a good time. But you know what would be terrible? He has planned. He has been a good steward. He has been a hard worker all his life. He has been an honest man. Are you with me? He has not been frivolous in his lifestyle, in his spending. He's been careful. He's been wise. He's managed his money. Are you with me? And if he just And if he died and turned it all over to us, and then we just went out and blew it in Las Vegas, we would deserve an incurable disease. But you know, that's what's happening in the world today. And not just with money. I'm talking with the spiritual gifts and heritage that this country and our forefathers have given. They've given us everything. They've given us the best Bible, the best doctrine, the best churches, amen, the greatest country. They've given us everything. And you know what America's doing? And you know what kids are doing? You know what people are doing all across the world? They're just blowing it. It's like that billboard in Decatur I saw where the policeman pulled a guy over, you know, and he's blowing, it's about being driving drunk, and he's blowing in this thing to test his alcohol level, and it says, you just blew $10,000, because that's the fine, I guess. Well, people are blowing a lot more than $10,000 today. They're blowing their innocence, their heritage, they're blowing their future. They're taking everything the forefathers worked for and lived for and died for, and they're just taking it and rubbing it in the mud. People that do that deserve an incurable disease. I remember kneeling at the casket of my grandfather, and it still weighs heavy on me. I got something to live up to. I got a man that kept his name pure, and he was honest, and he served God, and he loved God, and he walked with God. That's a heritage. My father and mother the same. But hey, even more than that, I've got a heavenly Father that's given me all things that pertain to life and godliness. Why would I take that and waste it? If I do that, I deserve an incurable disease. He received an incurable disease because he refused to walk in the ways of his father. He received an incurable disease because he wasted the great gifts of his father. And then he deserved an incurable disease because the Bible says, verse 4, now when Jehoram was risen up to the kingdom of his father, he strengthened himself and slew all his brethren with a sword, and divers also of the princes of Israel. He destroyed by wrath all of his godly brethren. You say, how do you know they were godly? Look over verse 13. This letter comes to him from Elijah the prophet. And the Bible says, thou but hast walked in the way of the kings of Israel, and hast made Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to go a-whoring like to the whoredoms of the house of Ahab, and also hast slain thy brethren of thy father's house. Look at it. Which were better than thyself. He had some good brethren, and he killed them all. And he not only killed his good brethren that were better than himself, but he killed divers also of the princes of Israel. You know what he's doing? He's killing everybody that's going to get in the way of his agenda. He's going to kill all the godly people that are going to be sticking the muds for the whoredom and the wickedness he's coming down the line with. He destroyed the godly. He destroyed the innocent. He destroyed the righteous because they were better than he was. He destroyed by wrath his godly brethren, and I'm telling you that incurred the wrath of God upon him. I saw something today, I told my son, man, the Bible is just an unbelievable book. I just said, wow. You ever read how many times God said somebody was better than somebody else? You know what happened? The same thing. Look at it. Go to 1 Samuel 15. 1 Samuel 15. He was so mad at people that were more godly than he was. You know what I see in churches today? People get mad at other people that are better than they are. Oh, boy. I mean, people, if somebody has a few more standards than they do, or loves God a little more than they do, or sing, you know, more involved in church, boy, they just hate their guts. I talked to a preacher not long ago. Would you please listen to me? I talked to a preacher not long ago, a pastor, and he said, Brent, you know what I believe? He said, I believe God's about through with the South. I almost wanted to fight, you know. South. I mean, I got the pictures on. I paid a lot of money for my portraits on the wall about the South. Born in the South. That means something to me. He said, hey, I think God's about through with the South. He said, you know why? I said, why? He said, because most of all the people in the South have destroyed the work of God just by fighting and fussing and splitting all the time. And he said, we people out here, you know, out west, well, there's not another Baptist church for a long drive. I'm telling you, you get an incurable disease when you feel a personal agenda to try to tear down and destroy everybody that are really better than you. First Samuel 15, verse 28. You think I'm hitting the wrong note? Read this. First Samuel 15, 28. And Samuel said unto him, he's talking to Saul. And Samuel said unto him, the Lord hath rent the kingdom of Israel from thee this day, and hath given it to a neighbor of thine. What'd he say? That is what? Better than thou. He's talking to Saul. You know who's better than Saul? David. You know what Saul tried to do to David? Kill him. You know what he had? He had an incurable disease he would die on a mountain for. No matter what David tried to do, no matter how David tried to prove himself, that evil spirit encompassed his bowels, and he had an incurable disease because he saw somebody that was better than he was, and he hated him. Boy, I see somebody that has a better walk with God than I do. I want to say thank you, Lord, and I wish I wasn't such a dirty so-and-so. I wish I loved the Lord like they. I find somebody that's got better or higher standards than I do, even if I don't agree with them. I want to appreciate them because, hey, if somebody's better than me, hey, I'm not going to throw rocks at them. I want to be like them. People have to be better than other people. They got to feel like they're better, and if they're not, they're going to tear them down. Well, 1 Kings 2, 1 Kings chapter 2. 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 32. And the Lord shall return his blood upon his own head, who fell upon two men. Look at it now. That's 1 Kings 2, 32. And the Lord shall return his blood upon his own head, who fell upon two men more righteous and better than he, and slew them with a sword. My father David, not knowing thereof, to wit, Abner the son of Ner, captain of the host of Israel, and Amasa the son of Jether, captain of the host of Judah. You know what the Bible said? Joab killed Abner and Amasa, and they were better than he was. He hated them. They got the position of the captain of the host that he wanted, and he hated them. They got the attention of the king that he wanted, and he hated them. And yes, they did have faults, but God said they're better than you are. Because you got a dirty, you got something dirty down in your bowels. You got some hatred down there. You ever read what the Bible says about bowels of compassion and bowels of mercy? You know what Job had? He had an incurable disease in his bowels. He was eat up with hatred and bitterness and wrath and anger. And he died for it. And you know who he was mad at? He wasn't mad at the devil, and he wasn't mad at sin. He was mad at the people that were better than he was. And you know what church people they get mad about? They don't get mad at the devil, and they don't get mad at false doctrine, and they don't get mad at sin, and they don't get mad at the bar, and they don't get mad at the sodomite crowd. You know who they get mad about? They get mad at each other. They get mad at just somebody in the church that's probably better than they are. You know what the Bible says about Daniel and his friends? They were 10 times what? Better than all the rest. You know what happens in the rest of the book of Daniel? Everybody's trying to kill them. It's an incurable disease. What does the Bible say about Abel in 1 John 2? Because his brother's works were righteous and his were evil. And Cain brought, or Abel brought, a more excellent sacrifice. He was better than Cain. So I'm going to kill him. Jehoram, he's eat up because he looks at his brothers and he wants to kill them. His own brethren. And church, I'm telling you, we've got too big a battle with the devil to even worry about each other. Do y'all understand that? There is such a fight against apostasy and sin. Look. Just overlook everything everybody ever does to you in this church. That would be a novel idea. You do it the workplace where you're getting paid. When you can't love and have compassion over your brethren, hey, I'm for being mad, man. I'm for being mad and fighting, but the fight's out yonder. He destroyed his godly brethren because they were better than he was. Boy, I got a lot more on that. I got to finish here. Go to, back to 21. 2 Chronicles 21. Don't get an incurable disease. Don't get put out with other people. Get put out with the devil. Get put out with your own sin. Somebody does you wrong, just forget about it. That's hard, isn't it? Just forget about it. I said, forget about it. If you don't, you might get a disease. Well, he also got an incurable disease because verse number 6 says in chapter 21, and he walked in the way of the kings of Israel, not Judah. And the king walked in the way of the kings of Israel. He was the king of Judah, but he's walking in the way of the kings of Israel. Like as did the house of Ahab. Watch it now. For he had the daughter of Ahab to wife. And he wrought that which was evil in the eyes of the Lord. He totally integrates himself with the world. Now that problem started with his daddy because his dad had a little business deal with Ahab, see. His dad had a little political deal with Ahab. But he just went farther than that. And he married Ahab's daughter. It's like marrying the family of the devil. By the way, kids, you marry somebody in God's family, not the devil's family. And what the devil's trying to do, he's trying to just water down God's seed to where it's so integrated with the seed of the world that it's just nothing but a bunch of jumbled mess. Just like Balaam told Balak to do with Israel. He integrates himself with the world. And you know what happens? This woman that he marries. He marries Ahab's daughter. And you know what happens in the long run? She becomes the queen. She becomes the ruler. Because after God killed him, then his boy gets up. And God kills him through Jehu. And so you know who gets to rule all of Judah? The wife of Jehoram, Ahab's daughter. The devil is trying to run the show. And a simple little integration will turn into the devil running the show. He'll just keep working it. Well, lastly, I got to hurry. Verse 11. Moreover, he made high places in the mountains of Judah and caused the inhabitants of Jerusalem to commit fornication and compelled Judah thereto. Good Lord. This is not only a fornicator. He is compelling everybody else. He is making them commit fornication. He's changing their school book curriculum so they'll learn how to fornicate. He's controlling the airwaves and the media and everything that gets put in the to cause everybody to fornicate. And he bursts the idea. Oh, let's have free love. Get out from all these rules. The Bible says in verse 13 that he made Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to go a-whoring, like to the whoredoms of the house of Ahab. He caused everybody to just whore around. You know, people don't use those words anymore. Whoredom, whore. You know, people don't like to be honest about what they are. And see, the world has smoothed it on down where it's not a whore anymore and it's not a bastard anymore. It's acceptable. It's nice. And it ain't nice. It's a disease. It is an incurable disease. And he's not only a commits whoredom, he gets everybody else to commit it too. And God says, I'm sick of that. You know, one of these days God's going to say, I'm sick of that. And it don't matter whose son you are. I'm sick of that. It doesn't matter what nation you live in. I'm sick of that. You refuse to walk in the way of your fathers. You wasted everything that you were given that was so perfect. You hated everybody that was better than you were. And then you're not content just to be involved in whoredom. You want everybody else to join in your whoredom. Yeah, well, you're going to get a disease. And you ain't going to find a cure. So the results were he just reigned for 8 years. And two of those years, the Bible says, he sits there with that incurable disease. Verse 19, came to pass that in process of time, after the end of 2 years, he suffers for 2 years with this disease. His bowels fell out by reason of his sickness. So he died of sore diseases. And the Bible said in verse 15, that great sickness by disease of thy bowels, until thy bowels fall out by reason of the sickness. Watch it, day by day, died a slow death. I'll never forget, I was talking to a preacher, I said, man, this preacher went off Fool's Hill, and I said, I'd be afraid God would kill me if I did that. And the pastor said, I tell you what, brother, I'd be afraid God wouldn't. He let me live with it, and day by day, destruction and judgment and guilt would just destroy me. Day by day, his bowels fell out. Day by day, a little bit at a time. You want to go God's way or you want to go devil's way? You won't watch that movie. And the Word of God says that when he died, verse 19, his people made no burning for him like the burning of his father. In the middle of verse 20, he departed without being desired. You know what happens? Nobody cares. You lived and you died and nobody cared. You know, when people care is when you do the will of God, when you have a heart for God, when you're faithful to God, and that's when the memory of the just continues to linger on, but the memory of the wicked rots. Nobody even cares. That's the result. Nobody cares. Just like Judas, his bowels fell out. Isn't that what it said? Stick him over there in some field. Get rid of him. We don't care. Because he had everything and he turned his back on it. And his heart was full of anger and malice and wickedness. And Jehoram, you're not even worthy of the family name, and they don't even bury you in the sepulchers of the kings. You're not worthy of any honor because you dishonored everything. Just bury you somewhere else. Nobody even cares that you were the king. And the last intriguing thing is in verse 12 when it says, there came a writing to him from Elijah the prophet. Do y'all know that's really weird? Because Elijah the prophet died a long time before that. Not died, he went to heaven, he left the earth, he was gone. Elijah, not Elisha. A writing from Elijah the prophet. When did Elijah write that? There's no record of it. Now, I know he could have written that way before this kid was ever born. I understand that. God can do that. He named Josiah 275 years before he was born. I understand that can happen. But it don't say. But you know what? Elijah still ain't dead, brother. That book says he's still standing up there. He's one of the anointed ones. Standing up there. He'd been standing up there for a long time. There's another message there. Watch how you complain to God. He may just make you stand there. Got caught up that chariot, went up to heaven. And just maybe God says, Elijah, you see that down there? Look at that boy. Look how he's messing up everything. Won't you write him a letter? Y'all do believe that could happen, don't you? Well, now, how could we just assume that he wrote it before he went up in the chariot? If he wrote it before he went up in the chariot, he could write it after he went up in the chariot. You think there's no pens in heaven? You know what I think? I think God Almighty sent Jehoram a letter from heaven. But the problem was, it wasn't to be a blessing. And church, we can either receive the Word of God as a wonderful blessing because we're in the ways of the Lord, or we can receive a message from God from heaven as judgment because we didn't want the ways of God. But either way, we're going to get a message from heaven. I don't want an incurable disease. I want a good story and a good letter.